Friends, in the name of our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, we welcome each of you to worship on this blessed second Sunday of Easter as the great 50 days of Easter continue. We thank you for joining us both in person today and those that are with us on YouTube or might be viewing the service later this week. Welcome in God's grace to one and all. Faith Quest, our Sunday school ministry, does meet today. If you're looking ahead, just 4 more weeks of Faith Quest this year. Teacher Appreciation Sunday is coming up quickly on Sunday, May 5th. That'll be the last Sunday of Faith Quest for this year. All new students, welcome to that ministry throughout the season. Friends, today, as always, we invite all to proclaim Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, to join us in the sharing of God's gifts through Holy Communion. All are welcome to God's table of grace. Your gifts and generosity are received as you leave the building today, and we thank you for those gifts and offerings that share in sustaining and blessing our ministry. New members, a new member Sunday is coming up quickly on Sunday, April 21st. New member conversation on Wednesday, April 17th. There's a new member letter and a new member card for you in the narthex. Should you be interested in that, we would love to have you be a part of that. That'll also be our anniversary Sunday, and we'll celebrate our anniversary together on April 21st as well. There's a blood drive coming up on May 8th, so start planning now to be a donor or a volunteer that day. We would greatly appreciate it. That brings us through most of the announcements for this morning. I want to take just a moment to talk about road construction. Some of you probably are really good at figuring things out all on your own. If you come from the south and go back heading south, probably not a big deal. Because you probably more often than not find your way on 165th turning in and turning out. So if you are on the north side and want to go north on Pilot, this little handout is actually available as well. But the red shows you where DOT is closed, likely through October, is what we're hearing. Okay? And then the green is one way to get in and out off of Pilot Knob. The yellow might be a preferred option for going north as you exit, okay? So you'll still want to go down Dodd Lane to 165th, but then take the last left-hand turn before Pilot Knob onto Elm Creek Lane. You can go north through the townhome development, and then when you get, you'll get to Dodd Boulevard at a stop sign, and you can turn right at that stop sign, and there you'll be at the stoplights at Dodd Boulevard and Pilot Knob, okay? It's just an awareness thing that I have. We've actually had, sadly, some members of Lord of Life get caught up in accidents trying to make a left-hand turn off of 165th to go north on Pilot Knob, so it takes a little extra awareness. I know that many of you, some of you live right across that way and you deal with it all the time, so you're really good at managing that and you know what to expect and how that all works. For those of you that aren't as familiar, this just provides an option or two. So just wanted to share that out of a little caution for you. We won't show it every Sunday, but we'll show it for a couple weeks. It's also on our website, thanks to Nate posting this. And then for those of you that like a hard copy, can I see that again? It got taken down and I didn't quite grasp it. There's a hard copy available for you in the narthex as well. So just some added awareness again for you. Friends, special thanks to all of our volunteers. Thanks to all those that shared in a most blessed and festive Easter Sunday last Sunday. Speaking of Easter, for the kids, there's still an Easter basket that will be available with a little goodie in it and a little message in it and some coloring books in it as well. If you weren't with us and want to know a little bit about what's coming up this year, there's an Easter card that has just some Easter greetings, but then it's got a calendar of events of those things coming. And if you weren't with us, or maybe you were with us or with us online and you saw the Peanuts cartoon, there's copies of that in that Easter basket as well. And then this is that handout that's available for you in the narthex as well. Friends, indeed, we want to again thank all those volunteers that are helping us this morning. Special thanks to Gretchen for playing and leading our service this morning. Always good to see you, Gretchen. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And she'll be back with us next Sunday as well. Great assurance and comfort to us, so thank you. Again, if you'd like to be a part of that volunteer circle, There's lots of ways to do that. There's a QR code in the narthex for you to scan and a little pickup form as well if you'd prefer the hard copy. Friends, indeed, the great 50 days continue, so we continue with the Easter announcement. I invite you, if you wish, and as you are able, to please stand. The Lord is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia. The peace of the risen Christ be with you always, and also with you. I invite you to greet those near and close to you as we begin our service and continue with singing together, Awake My Soul. Friends, today we celebrate God's grace is alive. We are alive and anew in the living peace, hope, and grace in the risen Christ, so we worship. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me, and he heard my cry. The Lord lifted me out of destruction. He stood me on a rock and made my feet steady. Friends, in the living grace of the resurrection, Jesus is here with us and puts a new song in our mouth. Hope and peace are truly alive and anew. A new dawn breaks forth. Jesus is risen, and we shall arise.
Heaven forever, oh, what
Happy are all who trust the Lord.
Lord,
happy are we whose peace is not found in false gods. For we announce the great deeds of the Lord, whose power and grace are alive here in our hearts. Today, celebrate the Lord will not hold back his mercy. Today, let us take time to silently confess our sins, those things we have done and left undone, which keep our hearts from seeing and believing the peace alive in the risen Christ. Friends in Christ, you are alive and anew, raised up in God's living grace in these words. Jesus saves. Jesus forgives you all your sins. Trust the risen Christ is right here, springing forth for you a living hope, a living peace. Celebrate, lift up your voice and sing. Alleluia, Jesus is risen, and we shall arise. To share together in the prayer of the day. Loving God, we celebrate with joy the resurrection of our Lord. Raise us up in new life to be alive and anew in your power and peace and grace right here in the risen Christ. By your Holy Spirit, put every one of our doubts aside. Awake our souls and give us faith to see and to believe anew. You are alive in our midst. Break this morning wide open once again to trust you, Jesus, have risen, and we shall arise in the living peace and grace of your presence. In the risen Jesus we pray. Amen. I invite you to be seated as we sing together, Jesus Loves Me. We invite the children forward.
Jesus loves me.
Good morning to each of you. Thanks so much for joining us today. Always good to see you. Can you guys look up at the camera up there and say good morning and happy Easter?
Good morning.
Happy Easter. Because you know it's Easter every day, even though we celebrate it one day with all kinds of festivities, and Jesus is celebrated that he rose from the dead on that day. It's Easter every day, thanks to knowing he's right here with us. Have you guys ever played the quiet game at home or at school or in the car? Do you like playing the quiet game? No? At least you're honest. Most kids don't like playing the quiet game because usually there's a strategy, right? Usually there's a strategy behind the game to kind of slow things down, quiet things down. Can we play the quiet game for just a second? Logan. Logan doesn't want to play. If we just try to stay quiet for just a second. Wow, very good. It's kind of hard, isn't it?
No,
you know what? Truth be told, I think it's hard for those people out there too. Okay? I think it's plenty hard for others. We love to have peace and quiet. We love to have quiet, but rarely does it last, right? There's a lot going on in our world and in our hearts. To Today we read an amazing, blessed story of Jesus, the night that he was raised from the dead, the first night, okay? Earlier that day, the others had gone to the tomb and seen that the tomb was empty and started to share the word that Jesus had risen. But nobody had seen him, really. There's one gospel account that talks about Mary seeing Jesus, okay? But others, it's just an angel talking. But now, in that upper room that night, Jesus comes into the midst of his disciples, and they're filled with being anxious. And you know what he says to them? Peace. Peace be with you. And he helps them know that calm and quiet and peace are right there in him, in his presence. So, whenever we need a little peace, real peace, not just for the noise to stop for a little bit, but peace in our heart, in our soul, on our mind, we can call out, Jesus, give us some peace. Come be with us and tell us, peace be with you. Will you pray about that with me today? Jesus, today we thank you that you're the greatest gift of peace that there is. Your peace that we have in you as the risen Christ doesn't just come and go. It's here with us, calming us, reassuring us, gracing us. And we know peace, real peace in you and in you alone. So come, make your living presence known to us and bless us with living peace in your grace. For we know Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia and amen. Thanks for joining me today. Many of you are on your way out for Faith Quest, our Sunday school ministry. Some of you are headed back to sit with family, friends. Some of you are headed out to the nursery because you just have so much fun with Bryn. And as they go their way, we thank Jeff for coming forward and leading our readings this morning.
The first lesson is from Acts, the fourth chapter. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power, the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and the great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. The second lesson is from 1 John, the first chapter. We declare to you what was from the beginning, what we have heard, what we have seen with our eyes, what we have looked at and touched with our hands concerning the word of life. This life was revealed, and we have seen it and testified to it, and declare the eternal life that was with the Father was revealed to us. We declare to you what we have seen and heard, so that you also may have fellowship with us. And truly, our fellowship is with the Father and with his Son, Jesus Christ. We are writing these things so that our joy may be complete. This is the message we have heard from him and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in him there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with him while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light as he himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make him a liar, and his word is not in us. My little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world.
The King is exalted on high. I will praise. I will praise him. He is exalted forever, exalted, and I will praise his name. He is the Lord forever, his truth shall reign. Heaven and earth rejoice in his holy name. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high. He is exalted, the King is exalted on high.
Friends, indeed, the one who is risen and risen indeed is the one who is exalted, lifted on high, right here in our midst to bring us peace. Living peace. A reading this day of the Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 20th chapter. I invite you, if you wish, to please stand. When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, Jesus showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When Jesus had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained." But Thomas, who was called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But Thomas said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands, and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then Jesus said to Thomas, "Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe." Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing, you have life in his name. My friends, the gospel of the risen Christ. Today we share our faith using these powerful words from Revelation chapter 21. God's Son, who was born in a manger, who went forward in obedience to make us all one through his death and resurrection, he will come again. While we wait for Jesus' return, we boldly share our faith, for we are alive and anew in the risen Christ, raising all to new life. God, who sits upon the throne, says, "Behold, I make all things new. Write these words, for they are trustworthy and true. It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. The thirsty I will give from the fountain the water of life without payment. They who conquer shall have their heritage, and I will be their God, and they will be my children." Amen. I invite you to be seated. We continue just prior to my message, watching and being blessed by this video in this time and season of renewal in the risen Christ.
Hopeless. Any dream of life crushed. In the grip of darkness, without any true source of light. I don't know why he chose me, when I had nothing to offer him. But that's who he is. His love flowed through my soul. He said, "Awake, awake." And it's no longer I who live, but he, the glorious one, life itself, Christ Jesus, who brought me back to life.
Lasted for you the way you needed it most. As I invited the children, even saying shh, even playing a little quiet game lasts for only so long, but then often a lot of noise comes our way as well. I love this story about a young college student. He moves away from home for the first time, and he's checking in with mom and dad a couple weeks into his stay at his new school. And they say, "So how's it going? Are you meeting some people? Do you get out at night? And what are your neighbors like?" And he says, "Oh, mom and dad." He said, "You know, my neighbors they're just causing a lot of commotion for me. I have one neighbor on one side. All they do all night is moan and groan and cry out, making these awful noises. Neighbor on the other side, all they do is bang on my wall. And the neighbor up above me just pounds and stomps on my ceiling, making so much noise." And they go, "Oh my goodness, that sounds like a lot. Have you told anybody about it? What do? Do you get a chance to go out at night, or are you always in?" And he goes, "Well, mostly I stay in because I need to practice my tuba, my saxophone, and the drums." Lots of noise. Lots of noise. Noise is all around us. Noise is also inside of us. We're invited to hear again the risen Christ come into our lives where we need him most and tell us, "Peace be with you." We all know what sin and brokenness and guilt and shame sound like and feel like. And oh, how we need Jesus to come into our midst and tell us, "Peace be with you." The disciples were in the upper room that first night. That very first night. Oh, what they needed. So many things they needed. And yet they were searching and wondering, could this be true? What if it is true? But the doors were locked for fear of the Jews, because if it isn't true, and even if it is true, the Jews are going to come looking for us because we're associated with him. Peter had fled and even denied the night of the arrest. "I don't know him." And there was an emotion in each of them that said, "Protect yourself." So for fear of the Jews, they locked themselves in. And let's be honest, not just for fear of the Jews. What if it is true? What if Jesus comes back? Peter's there, sitting there going, "I denied him." The others go, "Don't beat yourself up, Peter. He told us all to stay here and keep watch and pray. None of us stayed here, kept watch, or prayed. We fell asleep, and then when the soldiers came, we fled." So if he comes back, he's going to come after us saying, "Why weren't you there for me?" And why weren't we there for him? So much unrest. The disciples, so much uncertain in their midst. So many emotions racing and chasing in their lives and their hearts. And Jesus comes in, breaks into their midst, and says what they need to hear most: "Peace be with you." Shows them his hands, his side, and they know it is the Lord. And they're still hearing him say, "Peace be with you." Now, Thomas gets a bad rap. He wasn't there. You and I probably give him a bad rap. "Come on, Thomas, you doubted? Why couldn't you believe your friends? How would we have done if we hadn't been there and then were told? How do we do even today when somebody tells us, I've seen the Lord in a new way? Well, I haven't seen him in that way. Really? You've seen him in that way? I got to see him in that way for myself. Oh, but he's making himself known to you. Oh, that's powerful. That's miraculous. That's majestic. Thomas gets to see, so then he proclaims too, my Lord and my God. And Jesus says, thanks, Thomas, but you know, there are those who believe without even seeing. We're invited to put that doubting piece of each of us aside and trust anew the one who is in our midst telling us, peace be with you. To believe as the apostles and those that heard the apostles proclaim, as Jeff read for us today, that they made him known through their proclamation, the resurrection of the dead. And then to hear further from 1 John, this is the one. We're making him known. We're telling you about him. So we're invited to go tell, too. We all know, too, what stress, anxiety, worry, concern, uncertainty, the unknown sound like as well, and it's not peaceful. If you have a loved one going through anything, if you yourself are going through anything, if you've had the loss of a loved one come your way, you know exactly what it is to feel empty and broken and alone. There's not any peace. So where does that peace come from? The risen Christ breaks into our midst to be with us, to stir us up and to let us know he's right here where we need him most. And peace is with us in the midst of all that is broken, in the midst of all that weighs on us. I have a saying that I share with a group that I work with often that says, don't let what weighs you down shut you down. It's all too easy to have it happen. And when we know that even in the midst of what weighs us down, the Christ breaks forth and lifts us up, then that can't weigh us down, even a little. There's strength in even a little in knowing peace is with us. Kind of related to these first two points is a favorite story of mine. There's three gentlemen, they get together, and they talk about all kinds of things. And one day they decide, as they're gathering and meeting, to talk about, if you could come back as anyone, historical or present, who would you choose to come back as and why? And one guy starts with, I don't know exactly who I'd want to come back as, but I'd like to come back as someone during biblical times. Because I'd like to know and see all of that happening firsthand, right in my midst. Another gentleman says, I'd love to come back during the time of the Enlightenment. There's so much progress going on right now, but back then it was happening right in front of people. They were learning so much, being exposed, and having so much new revealed to them, and their eyes were being opened in new ways. I'd like to come back then. Third guy says, I'd like to come back as myself. And the guys look at him and kind of snicker and go, really? Seriously? Why do you want to come back as yourself? He says, I'd like to come back as myself and do some of things more right that I did wrong. Not do some of the mistakes that I made. Live more for others than I have. I'd like to come back as myself and make all of that right or fresh in new ways. And that's when he hears a little voice. Let's say it's the voice of the risen Christ saying that's what today is for. That's what the rest of today is for. That's what tomorrow is for. For us to know peace is with us so that we can put the old behind, just like those disciples, just like each of us, and live today in a new way, in a new filled way, in a new blessed and graced way, thanks to the one who is right here in our midst where we need him most. One of the biggest questions I've often had at times throughout my ministry is people coming to me saying, I'm praying for a loved one. They don't know Jesus enough. They don't know Jesus the way I want them to know Jesus. Helping someone else in their spiritual journey is not easy. being there like Mary proclaimed last week in the Easter Gospel, I have seen the Lord. Being there as the disciples in our reading today are trying to tell Thomas, we have seen the Lord. It's not easy. Helping others see that Jesus in their life is a longing and a calling and a prayer that we, so many of us, lift up on behalf of loved ones. And it leaves us often filled with unrest, filled with so much uncertainty in our life. So we're asked and we're invited to trust anew that the Holy Spirit continues to be at work in their life as we go and tell more of the story and live out the story and make it known. I want to put this in perspective just a little bit by sharing with you a little tidbit that some of you may already know and probably many of you are tracking and awed by as well. Many of you know I love athletics, I love sports, I love March Madness and all the stories behind the stories and everything that's going on. There's a team from Iowa, right? playing later today, a team from South Carolina. South Carolina, by the way, has a freshman on their team from St. Michael, Albertville, and a great athlete and making a difference for that team as well. But one of the stories that has drawn people in is to follow this. Okay? Maybe you've seen or heard some of these numbers. Last year, when Iowa played LSU in the women's Final Four national championship game, they drew over 9.9, I think, million viewers. Okay? This year, when LSU and Iowa played in the regional final just a week ago, okay, they drew over 12 million viewers. The other night when Iowa played UConn in the semifinals of the National Final Four, they drew over 14 million. Okay? To put this in context, last year during the World Series, not one game reached 12 million viewers. Not one. And only one out of the five finals for the NBA reached 12 million viewers. Okay? That's the draw of this. Everybody's anticipating what will the number be today when Iowa plays South Carolina for the national championship. Now, to put this in context, why would I even bring this up? I'm sharing a message, a sermon, right, on a Sunday morning. There are an estimated, in this country alone, remember that viewership was amazing, 14 million. There are an estimated, in this country alone, 332 million Christians who know that Christ is risen indeed, hallelujah. Worldwide, there are 2.6 billion Christians who know Christ is risen indeed, hallelujah. And he's the one giving us peace, real peace. The peace that we need, the peace that is beyond all understanding. Viewerships are amazing. How many of those 2.6 billion were in a ministry or saw a ministry or were part of a ministry last Sunday and in this week? Celebrating the peace that is with us, the peace that we are each longing for. In a moment, we're going to sing, Lord, I Need You. And then we're going to continue with a Litany of Peace on a yellow insert in your bulletin, and you'll see it on the screens. Take the handout with you if you've never seen it before. This is a Litany of Peace that is written based on scripture that I know many of you know these phrases and passages very well. The reason I bring this up is we are celebrating our anniversary in 2 weeks on April 21st. Back on April 2nd, 1995, we worshiped for the first time as a faith community at Aiken Road Elementary School, and it was the fifth Sunday in Lent. Okay, we gathered the following Sunday on April 9th, it was Palm Sunday. We gathered the following Sunday on April 16th, and it was Easter. We gathered the following Sunday, and it was April 23rd, the second Sunday of Easter. The same text read, Peace be with you. Some of you are more my generation than others, and yet some of you know the stories all too well. What happened on April 19th, 3 days after Easter 1995? The bombing of Oklahoma City. We gathered on the 23rd needing peace. What happened on April 20th, 1999, 4 years later? The shooting at Columbine High School. We need peace. September 11th, 2001. Al-Qaeda, ISIS, Hamas. Afghanistan, Iraq, Ukraine. Our military servicemen and women in so many deployments serving so many areas around the world. Still today, we need peace, real peace. We live in a deadline society. We get to the next thing and we check that off and we go, phew, oh, wait a minute, I got the next thing, right? Where's the peace in that? We're longing for peace, real peace, still today. And that doesn't even begin to include what you are going through. Health battles, loss of loved ones, financial concerns. Since then, we've had a financial crisis, right? Back in the early 2010, 11, 12, all of that. We've had a pandemic. And then again, to circle back, each of you, the prayer list is only growing here at Lord of Life. People longing for peace, living peace, to be right here where we need him most. So, when you are feeling the least bit unsettled, the least bit worried, a little concern or stress coming your way, news of a loved one or for yourself, and you need it most, ask Jesus to come into your midst and to tell you what you need to hear most. Peace be with you. Peace be with you, my friends. Trust anew the one who is living. Peace is right here where we need him most. For Christ is risen. Christ is risen indeed. Alleluia and amen. We continue as we sing together, the Lord, I need you.
Yes.
Continue today, friends, with this litany for seeking peace and calm in the midst of an uncertain world. Lord, you know what consumes our hearts these days, and yet we join the words of old. Hear my cry, O God. Listen to my prayer from the ends of the earth. I call to you when my heart is faint. Lead me to the rock that is higher than I, for you are my refuge, a strong tower against the enemy. Loving God, life's events often open our hearts to how vulnerable and fragile life is. Life is uncertain for us and our loved ones. Today we share the words God spoke through the prophet, "Comfort, O comfort my people." God still sends words of comfort and hope. We trust God says to us again today, "Do not fear, I have created you and formed you. And I have called you by name. You are mine, and I am with you." Friends, God says, "I will make with them a covenant of peace. I will make them and the region one of blessing. They shall be secure, and I will break the bars of their yoke and save them from the hands that hurt them. They shall live in safety, and no one shall make them afraid." Trust Jesus Christ is risen and lives to fulfill the covenant. But, Lord, we are afraid. We wait and pray for your promises to be fulfilled. At times, our voices join those of the psalmist, those of our Savior, and we too cry out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me, from the words of my groaning? My God, I cry to you by day, but you do not answer. I cry to you by night, and I find no rest. Lord, in the midst of our anger and fear, keep us calm, comforted, and assured. For the psalm continues, "In you alone our ancestors put their trust, and you delivered them. To you alone they cried, and they were saved. And in you alone they trusted, and they were not disappointed." Lord, your power alone rules all creation. Yet at times we weep and we cry out like the words of long ago. I lift my eyes to the hills. From where does my help come? Trusting in you alone, we announce with unwavering conviction, my help comes from the Lord who made heaven and earth. Lord, when confidence is shaken, when we are not sure where to turn, what to do, what to hold on to, speak to us. Assure us, as you did Paul, your grace is sufficient. Your power is made perfect in weakness. As we search to hold on to peace and order, increase in us such faith to trust what is true. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness will not overcome it. Creator of life and peace, give us faith and courage to trust you when you say the day is coming when swords will be beaten into plowshares, and spears into pruning hooks, and nation will no longer lift up sword against nation, and war will be no more. Give us the peace only you can give, that all might see and realize and hold fast to your promised word. For the wolf shall live with the lamb, the leopard shall lie down with the kid, the calf and the fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. At times we feel alone or isolated. Today we give thanks, Lord, you are the tie that binds us together. We trust Jesus continues to pray on our behalf that all people may be one people. Even in times of despair, Jesus, you are faithful, and we remember you are with us always to the close of the age. As we hear God's word, which restores us and gives us hope, we remember how God restored and called the Apostle Paul. Paul wrote words of great conviction, even in the midst of trials and uncertainties. Let us state our faith today, trusting and announcing the foundation of faith we hold on to, and the promises of God, neither of which will ever fail us. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own son, but gave him up for all of us, Will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus who died, yes, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who indeed intercedes for us. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor powers nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Though the world reminds us we are vulnerable, the risen Jesus invites us to live today in confidence and hope. Do not worry about your life. If God clothes the grass of the field, will he not much more clothe you? And not one sparrow falls to the ground apart from the Father. Do not be afraid, for you are of more value to him than the sparrows. When we are troubled, God gives us peace that passes all understanding. He keeps our hearts guarded and our minds in Christ Jesus. Therefore, let us love one another as he has loved us. For peace comes in knowing God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that all who believe would not die but have eternal life. In grace and peace and hope, we pray anew the prayer of St. Francis. Lord, make us instruments of your peace. Where there is hatred, let us so love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is discord, union. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. Where there is sadness, joy. Grant that we would not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand, to be loved as to love. For it is in giving that we receive, it is in pardoning that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen. I invite us to share just a couple brief petitions this morning. Gracious God, we give you thanks that you are peace, real peace, living peace. Right in our midst where we need you most, for you are the Christ and you are risen and risen indeed. We each know what sin and brokenness and guilt and shame sound like, and you bring us peace. We are alive and anew in your peace alone. We all know what worry and stress and fear and anxiety sound like and feel like. And yet you, the risen Christ, are our living peace, and so whatever weighs us down will never shut us down. You will lift us up again and again. The world is restless. Our lives are uncertain at times and restless. And so we need your peace right here where we need you the most. Bring peace to us and grace us anew as we pray to you, Jesus, risen Savior. Raise us to live anew in your living hope and grace. Almighty God, we do join the word of the prophet long ago. Comfort, comfort your people. In every corner of the world, all across creation, throughout our nation, in our own regions and circles of family and friends and loved ones. You know the prayers that we've been lifting up for those around the world. We continue to lift up one and all in every corner of this world of yours that is longing for your peace. And then we take time to pray today for those longing for peace right here at Lord of Life. The Burke family, the Holtzes, the Haneys, and the Zuries. The Mitchells, the Feldmans, the Henches, the Wrights and Hathaways, the Austins, the Kelton, Joy, Carlson, and Flum families, the Berners, the Kathy Wright family, the Scrivanis, the Huddles, the Hubbards, the Nymans, and the Dows, the Stateses, the Blaisdell and Michael Chambers family, the Tefts and the Connollys, the Newmans, the Butlers, the Provosts and Curtis families, the Bundy and Anderson family, the Popples, our sister in Christ, Cheryl Nelson, the Melhops, the Claters, the Eads, the Rogers and Obergs, the Pierces, the Blahas and Reeses, the Tavernas, the Lundys, the Weirs, the Boxrucker, the Ellers and the Diaz families, the Leweberts, the Dions and the Schwartzes, the Hendersons and the McDowells, the Raitses, the Brian and Valerie Anderson family, the Lenbaums and Tafts, the Pettersons and Zimmermans, the Thompsons of Marine and Amory, the Burnses, the Peaches, the Martinez and the Valverdes. And those we now name silently and privately in our hearts at this time. all these things and whatever else you see we need, grant to us, we pray. For into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen. Friends, I invite you, if you wish, to please stand. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ took bread and gave thanks. He broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Take and do this now for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup and gave thanks, gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Take and do this now for the remembrance of me." Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I invite you to be seated, and then let us come and be fed and filled with the grace of Christ. invite you, if you wish, to please stand. The body and blood of our risen Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in the living grace of the risen Christ this day, this most blessed and holy morning, and on into life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of those whom you have fed with one heavenly food, through Jesus Christ, the risen Lord of life. Amen. Friends, the risen Lord bless you and keep you. The risen Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The risen Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace, for you are alive and anew in the living grace of Jesus Christ, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed.
Alleluia. With Easter hearts, let us go in the peace of Christ, alive and anew, celebrating the love of God and serving the risen Lord of life. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Thanks be to God for our time of worship. Thanks be to God for each of you. Our celebration continues with Christian fellowship, a blessed week in God's living grace and peace to one and all.